Good evening, guys. So today the session, the topic of today's session is Traffic, a Modern Reverse Proxy, presented by me, Yatharth. I'm Yatharth and working in Noldus as a software consultant. So before going over to the topic, first we need to take care of these Nolix etiquettes, which is we need to stay punctual. Next, just after the session, do send a constructive feedback and please keep yourself on mute unless required. So agenda of today's session is first we will talk about what are proxies and reverse proxies. Then we will talk about why do we need traffic, and afterwards we are going to see what traffic is, then going on to its architecture and the components it has. Next, we will talk about how traffic works upon Kubernetes, and finally there would be a short demo. So first we will see what basically are proxies and reverse proxies. So if you talk about proxy, so what's the use case of having a proxy? So the system goes like, basically we have some kind of application servers, which are our own the servers where our current application is running, and we have a particular system which need to interact with those servers. So what we do is, we basically, we just to hide our identity, what we do is we set up a forward proxy, or you can also call this a proxy server. And whenever we send a request to the client server, or you can say the application, so instead of going our request directly to the application servers, it firstly initially goes to a proxy, and then that proxy forwards our request to the application servers. So it is something which is used to hide the client from getting known on the server side. So if I talk about, suppose these are the servers of Google. So Google assumes that the request is actually made by this proxy server, but actually the request is not initiated by this proxy server. Instead, the request is actually generated by our systems. Yeah, so this is what a proxy is. This is also known as forward proxy. Now, talking about reverse proxy is something opposite of it. And what it does is, basically it hides the identity of the application servers instead of the client. So in the forward proxy, we saw that we are hiding the client. In the reverse proxy, we are actually hiding the application servers from directly being hit. So reverse proxy is again a kind of layer, if a front layer over application servers, and whenever we hit a request, suppose to google.com, so the response which we are getting is from the reverse proxy and not from the application servers. And those application servers, what they do, the reverse proxy basically forward the request to the application servers, they give the response back to reverse proxy, which then forwards the response to the systems from where the actually request is generated. So this is a difference between proxy and reverse proxy. So why I have covered this, because if you talk about traffic, so traffic is basically a reverse proxy. So before coming to know that what a reverse proxy is, that is something which is kind of a prerequisite. So now the topic comes is, why do we need proxies, or you can say reverse proxies? Or you can say why there is a need of traffic. So let's talk about a simple architecture. So suppose I have a Node.js application which is running, which is basically connecting to a database, and suppose I have multiple clients. So the normal procedure goes like, the system will be hitting a request to the servers, and the server will be querying the database if required, and finally generating the response and giving the response back to the client in a form of JSON. Now the problem arises. Suppose I want to scale up these servers. I want to have 5 servers, and obviously they are going to have different IPs. So how my client is actually going to hit those servers? So So one of the solution could be that we can append or we can add a load balancer in front of the in these servers. But again, the problem is that suppose now I have n number of applications, suppose 5 applications. So you need to turn off 5 load balancers to load balance those applications. So again, that will be a problem for us, a problem in terms of cost, because each load balancer is going to cost a huge amount to us. So that is something again not an efficient solution. So what is the solution we should go for? So for that, traffic comes into picture. So traffic is something, it's kind of a smart load balancer. So it sits in front of our application architecture, whole of our application. Now suppose these are 4 different applications running over my basically architecture infrastructure. I have 4 different applications running over it, and suppose we have multiple servers, or like suppose this node application is scaled up to 3 nodes, this one scaled up to n number of nodes. So even if they scale up or scale down, so everything is taken care by traffic. So whenever we hit hit any query or request any data from the application, so that is initially taken care by traffic, and traffic then forwards it to the servers basically to which we have queried. So it is intelligent enough to detect to which server should I send the response request to, and finally it gets the response from that server and then give it back to us in form of JSON or any other form, so mostly JSON. So yeah, so this is the basically kind of a desired architecture which traffic provides to us. So yeah, so any question till here in terms of architecture or the use case I just showed you where traffic helps us? Okay, so going next, what is traffic? So as I said, that traffic is basically a reverse proxy, as I just showed you that it is basically hiding the identities of my application servers and is sitting in front of my application servers, and the client are getting the responses from the proxy and not directly from the application servers. So that's why it's a reverse proxy. And I have written it is a reverse proxy for HTTP and TCP. So by saying HTTP and TCP, it means that it basically works for both layers. When we talk about networking layers, we have 7 layers. So TCP works on layer 4 and HTTP works on layer 7. So traffic provides us the load balancing facility for HTTP traffic as well as TCP. It means that it works over layer 4 as well as layer 7. So that's a good part of traffic. Next is that it is an open source. So yeah, the third one is that it is written in Go. As you can see, even see the logo of traffic. This is a gopher, which is given by a Go language basically. So this is written in Go. Next is that it is also known as an edge router. So what is an edge router? Can anyone know what is an edge router? Okay, so let me tell you, edge router is something which sits on the edge of our architecture and basically routes the traffic which is coming inside our whole infrastructure. So that is known as an edge router, as the name suggests. Next is that it is an it provides an automatic TLS. So the benefit it provides is that it supports both HTTP as well as HTTPS traffic. And why I said automatic, I'll come to that in just a few moments. Next is that it supports HTTP 2 as well as WebSockets. So if we talk about protocols, it has support for HTTP 2 also as well as WebSockets also. So that's again a good part of traffic. The next is that it is a cloud native. So it's it can be deployed over on premises as well as over the cloud service providers. So it is completely compatible with them also. So the next is auto service discovery. So that is the most amazing part of traffic. let's suppose in our architecture or in our infrastructure, if we're deploying, if we have suppose three services and now we are extending to four or five applications, I'm increasing my applications to four or five. So we don't need to tell traffic that yes, we are increasing, we are basically creating or deploying new services. It automatically discovers those services by talking to the providers. What are providers? We will come to that later. But yeah, that is something which traffic provides, that it automatically discovers what are the services that are running on our current infrastructure that need to be routed to. So yeah, that's the, again, a good part of traffic. So yeah, so as I said that it provides automatic TLS. So this is the part which makes it automatic, which is basically Let's Encrypt. So Let's Encrypt is a system which is used to provide free SSL certificates. So SSL certificates are those certificates which are basically used when you create your, when you basically changes your application from from HTTP to HTTPS. So the in between, the things which add upon is basically the SSL certificates, and that are created for free from Let's Encrypt. And Let's Encrypt integration is already there with traffic. So that's again a very amazing thing for traffic. Then other part is that it is native compliant to Docker and Kubernetes. It means that instead of running it directly on our systems, we can even deploy it over Docker as well as our Kubernetes. So that is something which can be done even in production environment. And another best part is that it is available in HA mode. So if you talk about highly availability, it supports that also. So yeah, so these are some of the very cool and amazing things about traffic. Any question in these points? Should I go ahead? Okay. Okay, so the things which I just said, so just to map them with a diagram, so here it comes. So basically it's like this is your infrastructure and this is the internet. So, and traffic sits on the edge of your infrastructure. So this is the infrastructure, and traffic is sitting on the edge of it. So that's why it is also known as edge router. And we have multiple on multiple domains we are getting the requests, and all the requests are basically for getting forward to traffic. And then traffic, as I said, so this is the logo of Let's Encrypt. So Let's Encrypt is also integrated with traffic, that's why, which allows to have basically SSL enabled with for all services. And then what traffic does is after getting the request, it forwards it to various you can say orchestrators. So we have Kubernetes, we have Mesos, we have Docker. So these are the providers to which traffic can communicate to. So yeah, so this is a diagram which shows. So suppose I'm getting a request over api domain.com, it is being taken care by traffic, and it automatically forwards it to the Kubernetes API server, which is running as a kind of, you can say, container within the infrastructure. So yeah. So next is the benefits of traffic as a reverse proxy. So so what are the benefits traffic provides when it acts as a reverse proxy? So the concept is basically the client doesn't know which server it is connecting to. So client actually don't know the exact server to which it is talking. The client the only thing that matters to client is that he is sending the request and he is getting the response. It doesn't, like, the things are abstract to him, that which actually the server is performing all the calculations and all. So these are the benefits we are getting. First is the load balancing. So suppose we have multiple servers running for a particular application, so that is being load balanced by traffic. The other is caching. So suppose if we are getting it caches the response of some request which can be reused, so that is again a facility provided by traffic. Another one is isolating internal traffic. So it isolating internal traffic means that basically the internal communication is not being suppose we have two services which are communicating to each other, so that is something that is not being externalized by traffic. So that's again a good part. The fourth one is logging. So basically it it maintains the logs of what are the requests which are incoming and what are the things responses which are outgoing. So it maintains the logs of that. And the fifth one is canary deployment. Okay, any idea about canary deployment? What is canary deployment? Okay, so let me tell you, canary deployment is basically you have like for a particular application, suppose you have two versions. One has one version has feature one and the other one has feature two, feature one plus feature two, and you want to test out feature two also with your actually live audience, you can say. So what you can do is you can divert a couple of traffic, like if you are per second if you are getting 100 requests, so what you can do is you can forward 5% of those requests to your new version of application and the 95% to the old version only. So and that with that you can actually test your application with the live basically users or clients. So that is a way of deploying services. So that is known as canary deployment. So that is again can be configured using traffic as a reverse proxy. So next is traffic as an edge router. So if we talk about traffic as edge router, so we can say that it basically sits on the edge of your system, and as I just mentioned it, whenever the request comes to traffic, it forwards automatically to your infrastructure, and the server will get basically process your request and give the response to traffic, and that traffic will forward the response back to the client. So that is again a role played by traffic. So next we will talk about the architecture of traffic. So if you talk about the component, so the first component that comes to traffic is this orange box. Do you see this? So this is basically a provider, like the infrastructure to which where the traffic is running. Is it our own system? Is it Docker? Is it Kubernetes or what? So this is the first thing, which is you can see the provider. Next is that we have entry points. So entry point is tells you what am I listening to. So basically it tells you whatever the request is coming to will be firstly going to come to entry points. So suppose I am hitting www.google.com. So that google.com, so that is a kind of a request forwarding to and if it's a HTTPS, so it will be forwarding to port number 443. So that will be handled by entry points. Next it will be taking that request and it will be checking out the routes, or you can say the basically some these are the rules which basically connects your application to the services. Services are those which are running over your infrastructure. So these are rules. And next is the middlewares. Middlewares are basically are shant ho jao bappa ji main. Yeah, so and so services are basically these are the things which are running over your infrastructure, and the routes routers are what which connects your entry points to the services which are running over your infrastructure. So these are even in routers we have two things. First are the rules and second one are middleware. But are these I'll discuss them in the later slide in brief. And the services I have already told you that these are the services which are running over your infrastructure. So first thing first, that what are providers in traffic. As I said, that providers are the plugins which provide configuration to traffic. So as I said, that traffic need to talk to something so that it can enable the automatic discovery of the applications which are running over your architecture. So that is something which is done by the provider thing. So traffic supports multiple providers. One is a file provider. The file provider is used when you are deploying traffic over your local system. Other is Docker daemon. Other is Docker Swarm. Other is Kubernetes, and then is Mesos. So Docker daemon and Docker Swarm. So these are basically orchestrator platforms of containers. Yeah, so this is all. Next comes the entry point. So if you talk about entry point are basically entry point, as I said, that tells you the actual endpoints to which we are communicating. So these includes the host names, the ports, the certification system information, and the authentication system. So these basically includes the domain names of our applications, so which are being resolved finally by the traffic. So these are entry points. Next comes the routers. So if I talk about routers, so routers is basically routers is in the change of connecting incoming request to the services. So as I said, that the requests which are coming to the services, they are finally being routed to the those services which are running over our architecture. So it is basically, it does this thing, it creates rules which include that from which entry point to which services do we need to connect, and that is something which is done automatically by traffic. We don't need to make those configuration rules automatically. So it is something taken care by traffic automatically. Next is middlewares. So middlewares are basically, this is kind of an optional component in traffic. And what it does is basically after my request is resolved, so routers now knows that this request need to be forwarded to this service. So after being before forwarding it, it can apply a couple of tweaks to my request. And what tweaks it can use, it can suppose add prefix. So add prefix is basically kind of a path modifier. So whatever path we are providing, it can modify that. Other one is basic authentication, to provide any kind of authentication to my application. Other one is forwarded auth. So forwarded auth is basically is a kind of authentication delegation to next is compress, is to compress the response, and then the redirect scheme. So there are a lot of middlewares available. There is a huge list. So these are some common middlewares which you might have seen when you basically work with the routes in your application also. So yeah, these are middlewares. So this is something a process goes like. So request comes from entry point, then to routers, and from routers it goes to middlewares if we have added any. So these are kind of optional. So after going through the middlewares and applying those tweaks, it finally goes to the service. So what are service? So services are responsible for configuring how to reach the actual services which are eventually handling the incoming request. So basically service are those which maps to the servers, the actual application servers where our application is running. So that's the benefit of services. So as is shown in this diagram also. So the load balancing part and the strictness part, all this thing are basically taken care by the services. So if you talk next, if you talk about configuration, so obviously if traffic is managing these huge lot of things, so obviously it need to be configured, or it need to be provided with some kind of configurations. So basically there are two kind of configurations which we need to have in traffic. One is static configurations and the other one is dynamic configurations. So static configurations are those which need to be provided just once whenever we start our traffic, where I need to just tell two things. The first one is providers and the second one is entry points. So when we talk about providers means to which thing should it talk to? Should it talk to my local system, or to Docker daemon, or to Kubernetes, or what? And the other thing is entry points. So entry points, again, the thing I just mentioned. So these two things are need to be provided whenever we start traffic. And the other one is our dynamic configurations. These are something which is taken care by traffic automatically. We don't need to provide any router or any middleware or any services. That is something that traffic automatically detects whenever we basically provide the, whenever it talks to the provider which we have configured in traffic. And how it does that, I will also show you the exact same thing over in the demo also. So this is about the whole architecture of traffic. So anyone, any question till here? Okay, so I believe we all are good till here. Next, coming to traffic over Kubernetes. So for those who don't know Kubernetes, let me tell you. So Kubernetes is basically an orchestrated platform. And when what do I mean when I say orchestrator? It basically it manages the containers. So if you guys must be familiar of Docker. So if we talk about Docker, we can simply create containers and we can simply destroy containers. But what about if I want to like manage those containers? Because it's easy if I like maintaining containers using Docker is easy if I am using 5 to 6 containers. But what about if I am running on 100 and 1000 of containers? So it would be a very difficult job for a particular person to basically, or you can say an administrator, to maintain all those containers, whether they are stopping, if any other container is not scheduling. So all of these things are being taken care by Kubernetes on its side. So that is basically an orchestrator platform. So why I mentioned Kubernetes, because that is one of the most popular orchestrator platform currently being used, and Kubernetes and traffic is basically compatible with Kubernetes, and it can deploy over Kubernetes. We can deploy traffic on Kubernetes. So if you talk about installation of traffic, we use a thing which is called Helm to deploy traffic over Kubernetes. So what is a Helm? Helm is basically a package manager. Because you all are using Linux, so you must be familiar of package managers. So package managers are like you like to install a particular package in your system. What you do is you write apt install and the package name. So same is Helm for Kubernetes. So if I want to install something over Kubernetes, I can use Helm. So for installing traffic, I can simply write Helm install traffic. So it can simply install traffic over Kubernetes. So that is about Helm. So next are the three concepts which we need to know about Kubernetes. Traffic is deployed over Kubernetes using these three concepts. First is ingress controller, second is ingress, third is ingress route. So ingress controller is something which is basically used to externalize those services which are running over Kubernetes. So suppose on my Kubernetes, I am running a 3-tier architecture. It means that it has a front end, it has a back end, and it has a database. So obviously I am going to expose only the front end of that service and not the back end as well as the database. So for backend and database, I'm not going to create any ingress, but for frontend service, I can expose them using an ingress object, which is being done by some kind of ingress controller. So in Kubernetes, there are various ingress controllers, like you might have heard about HAProxy and Nginx. So these are the popular ones. So one of them is traffic also, which is completely functional and can be used in production environments also. So that is what an ingress controller is. So next topic is ingress. So ingress is actually kind of a YAML file, or which actually provide the configurations to traffic to basically tell which service to be exposed out of the Kubernetes. Because by default, if you talk about the pods, or you can say the containers running over Kubernetes, they are only accessible within Kubernetes. So if I want to access those containers outside of Kubernetes, that is something not possible unless and until you use a different kind of services like NodePort. Or so these are some of the concepts of Kubernetes, and for exposing, one of the, you can say, the recommended way is ingress. So so ingress is a concept of exposing a particular service running over Kubernetes to the outside world. And third is ingress route. So ingress route is basically, it tells the configuration from which path. So that is something which is related only to traffic, because these two concepts, the ingress controller and ingress, this is something generic to all the ingress controllers which I just named, like I told you about Nginx, and I told you about HA proxy. So these two concepts are relevant to all the you can say ingress all the ingress controllers. But if I talk about traffic, so traffic has a ingress has a Kubernetes object which is called ingress route, which basically what it does is it creates a route from the external environment to the our Kubernetes service. So that is something taken care by traffic using an ingress route. Also for Kubernetes version 1.18 plus. So currently the latest Kubernetes version is 1.20, and from Kubernetes version 18 or above, we have two more Kubernetes objects which are ingress class and ingress. And what they do is basically so they basically provide a kind of, you can say, a unique name which can be used to expose the services. So this is ingress class and ingress. So these are again Kubernetes concepts. So, and this is how an application is basically you can say externalized. So we need to tell that it is an ingress, and we need to tell on which endpoint which service I am going to expose. So it what it says is that if I hit on example.net, like www.example.net, so it is going to basically hit a particular service which is by the name service 1 on Kubernetes on port number 80, and for that service it should hit the /bar path. And if I hit the same service with /foo, it is going to hit this service at port number 80. So that is something it tells you that is something how it is configured over Kubernetes if you talk about traffic over Kubernetes. So yeah, this is all about traffic and its installation over Kubernetes also. So anyone has any question till now? Okay, so coming to the demo part, let me show you that also. Okay, so do you see that this is a kind of a Docker compose I have written. So are you guys familiar with Docker compose? So okay, let me give you an idea what a Docker compose is. So a Docker compose is basically a file which is used to configure multiple containers within, so that if I run this Docker compose file, I am able to run multiple containers over my system. So let me show you with an example also. So this is my terminal. Going to desktop. So yeah, so this is the Docker compose. So initially, let me show you everything one by one. Okay, so basically, how I can run traffic. The main two key values in Docker compose is, first is the version tells you the main version of Docker compose. The other one is the services which I am going to run, which is basically the containers. So the first container I am going to run is basically a reverse proxy, which is by the name. So this is the Docker image of traffic, and the command I am going to use is api insecure true. Why I have to use this? Because this will enables my dashboard of traffic. I'll also show you how a dashboard look like. And you see that I am also providing that I am going to listen to Docker as a provider. So this is something where I mentioned Docker as a provider. So currently I am doing the demo over the Docker as a provider. So I am going to expose two ports. First is 80 and other one is 8080. Why 8080? Because I missed one thing about traffic, that traffic also displays everything on a particular dashboard it has. And that dashboard is actually exposed on port number 8080. So that's why I'm exposing port number 8080 as well as 80. And next, I am basically binding volumes. So what I am doing is I am basically binding var run docker.sock to var run docker.sock. Why I'm doing it? So that basically the traffic is able to talk to Docker daemon. So this is basically a socket through which my traffic pod would be able to communicate to Docker socket. So let's see what it will do. So if I run docker compose, and then up in a daemon, just a minute, let me see if my pod is okay. They are already running, so okay, let me turn them down first. Okay, so now if I run a docker ps, so you will see that I have only a console pod running, so we can ignore this, that is something different. So so now what I am going to do, I am simply going to comment these pods, and currently I am only going to run a reverse proxy over my system. So if I run docker compose up hyphen d, so you will see that if I do a docker ps, you can see that my traffic is up and it is exposing, is it running on port 80, as well as it is showing the dashboard on port 8080. So if I go to here and do a localhost 8080, you will see that I have my traffic dashboards. So you will see that everything which I just mentioned, you can see everything on my dashboard. So we have http, http port, we have traffic, this is basically the port number of the traffic dashboard. So these are routers, services, middlewares, everything. So we have, as I said, that it supports HTTP traffic as well as TCP as well as UDP. So it can communicate with all of them. And if I see that what are the things it is currently managing, so it is basically managing a reverse, you can see two pods. One is console. So do you see an amazing thing that because you, if I go to docker ps, so my console pod was already running, so that is something which is not the part of demo, but see console pod pod was currently running in my docker as a docker image, so it automatically configures itself that console is running. So I don't have to configure anything that I need to load balance, or I need to manipulate, or I need to basically configure console pod with traffic. So it automatically pick up the configuration by talking to Docker daemon. So that's a good benefit of traffic. So it is basically now load balancing too. So if I and now so these are the things I just mentioned. Now what I can do is, suppose if I run the rest of the services, so these are Nginx pods. So I have created four Nginx pods, which are basically some with the name, image name as Nginx, and I am exposing their port number 82.11.11.22.22.33 and 444. So you can treat these four containers as some four separate applications. So if I simply go and do a docker compose up hyphen d, so you will see that all of my pods will come up, and if I do a docker ps, all of my pods are running. And if I hit any of the services, which is basically localhost 1111, so you will see my applications are running. So and if I go back to traffic, you can see that it automatically configures Nginx 1, 2, 3, and 4, all of my application, it automatically configures itself within it. And we don't have to manually specify or anything within it. So next is basically how I can provide a particular route to these services is by using this. So again, this is an application which is who am I, so with an image traffic slash who am I, and I attached a label to it and provided a rules in the route services, which says that if I hit on whoami.docker.localhost, so it I am able to, if I like hit on this URL, my whoami service can be reachable. So that is something I did over here. So if I do a control S and again run my Docker compose up hyphen D and only the whoami pod, so you will see that my again a pod will come up by the name whoami here, this one. And if I as I mentioned here, if I just copy this IP and run it over here, my whoami service will be available, which basically tells you some information about the container pod. And and if I again go back to the traffic, so it you will see that whoami will again be configured within traffic, and we don't have to explicitly provide any configuration to traffic from my side. So it automatically configured that I am able to, it is able to basically, which is the best part of what you call automatic service discovery. So that's an example of traffic. So yeah, that is from my side. Yeah, I think we are done with the demo also. So any questions in this? Okay.
How do you make this traffic highly available?
Okay, yeah, so that's a good question. So basically, if you talk about traffic highly availability, so traffic what it do, it configures everything in its own pods. But if I suppose if I have multiple containers, so let me do one thing. So what it does is basically so suppose I assume that we have these three pods of traffic running over my system. So what we can do, what it does, it basically configures some kind of key value mechanism. So it that is something which can be configured with traffic. So you might have heard about console, or you might have heard about etcd. So these are some key value pairs. So if so how traffic achieves highly availability, we have multiple pods, and we just tell traffic that instead of storing the configuration within itself, what we can do is we can store all the configuration within these pods, which within the some kind of key value store, could be etcd, could be console. And now these are the traffic pods running. So now if we ask about if traffic is acting as a reverse proxy, and whenever traffic is getting any request, so it instead of providing the configuration by itself, it communicate to the console pod, or that key value pair pod, and it get the configuration from that, and after that it forwards our request to the actual service which is running over our infrastructure. So that's okay. How it maintains highly availability.
So traffic, right? So I can have a load balancer for routing it to different traffic servers. Is this like that as well?
Routing it, yeah. So it automatically load balances those services. That is something which is done by itself. Like, okay, let me show you that also. So if I, where is my terminal? Okay, so if I go to again to this, and are my pods running? Yeah, so professor, let's see, let's suppose if I scale this service, so if I do a docker compose up so if I scale the whoami service to 2, and now if I do a docker ps, you will see that I have two pods running of whoami, and automatically it will be load balanced by traffic. So if I come here, I will see that we have console is running, and whoami pod is running, and basically it is being load balanced by traffic. So Yeah, so that is something which is taken care by traffic automatically. So because it communicates with the provider, which is Docker in our case, and it automatically detects everything and manages everything on its own. We don't provide external configuration for that.
Good. Got it. Thank you.
Any more questions? Okay.
Thanks, Yatharth.
Okay, thank you guys.
Thanks, Vital.
Okay.